Thank you. All right. So first of all, welcome to all of you to our seminar today with Alexey Arbatov. First, some of the technical issues that I do want to say that, you know, this is a public seminar. It's being filmed, et cetera. Secondly, the usual admonition about cell phones not being active. But turning now to our guest, although I don't consider him really a guest, since he's a member of our board of directors. But Alexey is here to discuss an issue that, in general terms, is one that we here at NTI certainly spend a lot of time on, and that is the implications of and the ways to address what is not the best relationship right now between the United States and Russia, and what the implications are, particularly, of course, for us in the sphere of the nuclear threats, strategic stability, and the like. And in fact, many of you know, Sam Nunn and I had a paper published in Foreign Affairs that addresses this issue in general terms. It actually started out with a fictional scenario that regrettably had more plausibility in it than one would like in terms of a possible miscalculation leading to a very bad outcome. Also, just our U.S. ambassador to Russia until, I think, last week, John Huntsman, had an op-ed in the Wall Street Journal on Monday, very similar or certainly overlapping message in terms of we need more dialogue now and not less dialogue. And John emphasized the point that we also have in the past, that we need to start not just thinking about U.S.-Russia dialogue, but intra-American dialogue to create the political space to be able to have then the productive dialogues with Russia that we all hope at least will be coming. So I'm not going to say much more other than say that Alexey comes to us today, I have to say, I think, as a very creative thinker, and to provide a Russian view of these issues. I think I'm required to give some biographical, not biological. I was thinking of bio threats now also, but biographical issues. Alexey, well, first of all, he had substantial a decade in the Duma and was deputy chairman of the Duma Defense Committee. He is head of the Center for International Security at the Institute of World Economy and International Relations in the Russian Academy of Sciences, of which he is an elected member. I've already mentioned on our board here, and we look forward to seeing him back in a few weeks, in fact, for the board meeting. But again, today, so he will give his perspectives on U.S.-Russia strategic nuclear relationship. We had a good chat today, which I think, once again, I think, in my view, showed his interesting thinking out of whatever box we are in. Alexey tries to go outside it. So with that, Alexey, please.
Can you hear me? Well, thank you, Ernest, for this very generous introduction, and I'm very happy to be here. I do not feel like a guest, really. I feel like I'm at home, being on the board. Every time I come here, it's a great pleasure and honor for me. Now, talking about Russian-American relations, and in particular in the area of strategic relationship and arms control, some jokes come to mind. You know that Russian mentality and Russian history is such that we have many gloomy jokes, which we call black humor. And one of them goes like that. I decided that I have finally hit the bottom. Next minute, somebody knocked from below. So year after year, I'm coming here, and I think that it's as bad as it could be. It's the lowest level. But then I come next year, and it's still worse. One of the surprises for me in the present situation is that virtual collapse of arms control is a surprise to some people and some leaders, as if they have discovered it only now. In fact, professionals in NTI, Carnegie, Luxembourg Forum, MMO, my institute, have been warning about it, at least for the last 5 years. But all those warnings were met with deaf ear. Why is the situation as bad as it is? I do not want to give all the reasons, because the excellent article by Ernest and Sam in recent Foreign Affairs covers it thoroughly, and I do not have much to add to that. Those who have not read it, I very strongly recommend to do it. Against the background of this very gloomy picture with respect to arms control and the new arms race into which we are getting involved, I think there are three principal new schools of strategic thought which have emerged recently. One of them I may call nuclear revanchists. Those people who are now claiming that nuclear weapons, after deep reductions of the previous 30 years, have again become an effective instrument of foreign policy and even war fighting. You can find a lot of publications on that in the United States and in Russia as well. They claim that in the past, nuclear deterrence was the threat of retaliation in case of nuclear attack or massive conventional attack. Now, nuclear deterrence is the ability to effectively fight nuclear war, integrating employment of nuclear, conventional systems, special forces, and many other tools of warfare. And the prospect of possible victory is the best deterrence which each side can achieve. And it is to be gained not at the lower levels of nuclear arms, but hopefully for them at higher levels of more sophisticated, more effective nuclear and conventional arms. The second school may be called nuclear idealists. The nuclear ban treaty of 2017 in the United Nations is the product of the work of those nuclear idealists. Without putting into doubt their very good intentions, my judgment is that this treaty is absolutely utopian. It is utopian not only because it appeals to 9 nuclear weapon states to implement this treaty, well, neither of them has endorsed it. But that is not even the main reason. The main reason is that this treaty deals with nuclear disarmament as with a technical problem, and provides various measures and various ways to get down to zero. While in fact, nuclear arms during 75 years of their existence have become part and parcel of international politics, strategy, military planning, armed forces training, and so on. And you cannot just excise nuclear weapons from that environment as a malignant tumor. In order to go forward with nuclear disarmament, it is necessary to change this environment. That does not mean that we have to wait till the environment is changed to start nuclear disarmament. It will never happen in this way. Nuclear disarmament is an important avenue of changing this environment, but environment has to be kept in mind as well, because as you all here know very well, because here are professionals, nuclear weapons are designed not only to deter nuclear attack, they are designed to deter conventional attack, use of sophisticated new conventional systems. They are designed to provide security assurances to allies, which have no nuclear weapons. They are designed to support prestige and status of those states, nations, which have which do not have sufficient economic power to claim the role of great powers and leading states. And finally, for some countries, nuclear weapons are a bargaining tool to achieve recognition of their existence and their right to exist. And I mean not only North Korea. There are some other states like that. And the third school, which I call nuclear revisionists, those are the people who in the past were quite involved in nuclear arms control. Sometimes they are newcomers. And they say, well, in the past, nuclear arms control was useful. It served its purpose, but no longer, because situation has changed dramatically. And from now on, we do not have to continue with arms control treaties, talking about particular weapon systems, establishing ceilings and sub-ceilings and reduction and purification measures. We have to arrange barriers, multilateral forums, which will discuss the new understanding of strategic stability, ecosystem of arms control, establishing new rules for robust nuclear deterrence, not reducing weapons, but robust nuclear deterrence, and ways to improve transparency and predictability of strategic relationship. Of all three schools, you may be surprised, but I think that of all three schools, the third one is the most counterproductive, because it basically tells new political leaders something which they are very happy to listen to. They say the crisis of nuclear arms control is natural. It could not be avoided. And do not worry. We can live without arms control treaties. We can live with new environment discussions of the type that I mentioned. And for many political leaders, this is a very pleasant news, because instead of conducting exhausting negotiations for many years and resolving a lot of difficult problems at the table of negotiations, as well as even more difficult inside their countries when they have to find a compromise with competing agencies and industrial groups, they could go to conferences, pronounce speeches, and think that they are creating a benign environment for international security. The two principal assumptions of this revisionist school are that the world of bipolarity has changed to the world of multipolarity. And the second, that the new technologies are so elusive, so sophisticated, so complex, that traditional arms control cannot deal with them. That's why we have to invent something absolutely new. Let me consider those two assumptions in more detail. About multipolarity, yes, the world is multipolar and very disorderly. But if we are talking about nuclear weapons, we should look at the nuclear facet of this multipolarity. And in nuclear weapons, it's basically very much the same bipolarity as it existed 30 years ago. 30 years ago, before the signing of START 1 treaty, the two superpowers had about 98% of nuclear weapons among themselves, between the two of them. In 2010, when the new START was signed, they had 95%. Now they have about 92%. So no revolutionary change happened there. The numbers were reduced dramatically, and I'm very happy about it, about an order of magnitude reduction. But within the remaining strategic arsenals, it is still largely a bipolarity. Of course, quantitative aspects are not the only ones that matter. Qualitative matter too. In this respect, China is a new factor, growing China with growing nuclear and conventional forces and sophisticated new precision guided systems. It has to be taken into account, no question about it. But it is important to keep in mind that bringing China into negotiations, to say nothing of other nuclear weapon states, would require a lot of sacrifice from the two superpowers. It's not the third countries that will have major concessions. It's the two superpowers, which are up to a lot of very unpleasant surprises. First of all, in order to engage China, for example, the two superpowers will have to accept a number of rules of arms control, because they want China to engage in arms control. One is recognition of Chinese right for its own nuclear deterrence, and even for its own assured destruction capability against both Russia and the United States. Second, it is the Chinese right to achieve parity at the end of negotiations when agreement is reached. Not necessarily overwhelming parity, but parity in those systems and weapons which are to be subject of negotiations and agreements. And I do not think that the two superpowers are ready to accept parity in most respects, in most aspects of strategic balance with China. And of course, verification. China is a very specific nation. It's the only nation of the five legitimate nuclear states, which is totally opaque about its nuclear forces and nuclear programs. So verification with China will be a great headache. Now, let's look at only two examples. For instance, the Trump administration is saying that INF treaty of the future has to involve China. And allegedly, according to American estimate, China has about 2,000 conventional and nuclear medium and short-range missiles, which were the subject of INF treaty. So, propose to China to do something with these weapons, to cap them or to reduce them, and so on. China, if it comes to its senses and agrees to participate in arms control, would immediately respond with very logical and legitimate claims. For instance, it would say, if we are dealing with land-based cruise missiles, let's deal with sea-based cruise missiles, of which the United States has about 6,000 ships and submarines. Let's deal with air-launched cruise missiles. Indirectly, they are addressed by START treaty, but since bombers are counted as one delivery system and one warhead, in fact, they are not dealt with. Here are the areas where United States and Russia have huge superiority over China, and China would require commensurate reductions of those systems if China is to agree to limit or reduce it's the only advantage that China has. Take START. Again, the administration is saying that the next START agreement should involve China. Well, if we are ready to go down in START level by 7 or 8 times in our delivery systems, China would agree. If we are ready to provide China with the right to build up by 7 or 8 times, they might also agree. But is it good for us? What will be the reason for more horror, going down and providing China with legitimate right to build up? I do not know, but certainly the free cheese is only in a mousetrap. And if you want to involve China, you have to be ready for a lot of sacrifices to make that possible. So as Americans say, be cautious with your dreams. They may come true. What about new technology? The list is well known. I will not dwell on each of those. It's conventional precision-guided systems, both cruise missiles, ballistic missiles, and boost glide systems, hypersonic weapons, including cruise missiles and boost glide systems. It's drones, possibly with artificial intellect. It's cyber warfare, its space weapons, and a number of other innovations. Is that such a revolution that traditional arms control cannot address those new developments at all? First of all, I would remind you that military technological innovations happened all the time in the past, and they affected very drastically arms control. For instance, remember MIRVs, multiple independently warheads, in the beginning of the 70s, which made a revolution, produced a revolution in strategic balance, because they provided for capability of disarming counter for strike, even having parity in delivery systems and warheads. Remember cruise missiles by the end of the 70s, which nullified air defenses and provided for capability of low altitude, changing trajectory strike against command and control centers and national authority centers with zero warning time for that period. Remember Strategic Defense Initiative, which accumulated such a package of technological breakthroughs, compared to which the present ones do not look so impressive. And by the way, nuclear arms control eventually found the ways of dealing with all those revolutions. With MIRVs, under the New START, we came down to the number of warheads which the two parties had before development and deployment of MIRV missiles. With cruise missiles, we dealt with them at START 1. We dealt with ground-based cruise missiles at INF, with INF treaty. With Strategic Defense Initiative, the work of the commission chaired by Senator Nunn proved that testing of exotic weapons in space runs against Article 5 and Common Understanding D. And that saved the ABM Treaty and saved arms control, which was based on that, and led eventually to curtailment of this very massive, huge program, which was called Star Wars. Of course, capabilities of arms control are not infinite. There are many things that arms control cannot address now, maybe in the future, but some of them even in the future. In the past, arms control was unable to deal, for instance, with accuracy of nuclear weapons. It was unable to deal with flight time of nuclear weapons. It was unable to deal with tactical nuclear arms, with space weapons, and with a number of other important innovations which were left without limitations and reductions. However, during the past 50 years, nuclear arms control achieved a number of great historic victories. Non-proliferation treaty, ABM treaty, INF treaty, conventional force reductions in Europe, treaty, START 1, CTBT, and due to that, the nuclear weapons were reduced by about an order of magnitude, and strategic balance has become much more stable in a sense that the capability of disarming nuclear strike now is much smaller, much lower than it was 30 years ago. In the future, and this is my opinion, which certainly may not be accepted by many people, in the future, arms control can deal with many of the new innovations which I mentioned. And it can deal with them at the bilateral US-Russian format. If China finally will join, they would be welcome. But we do not have to wait for that. We can continue in a bilateral format. Of course, nuclear and arms control in general has to adjust to changing technologies. It cannot stay the same. And one of the reasons why we have now this whole package of new technologies which we do not know how to deal with is because for the last 20 years, nuclear arms control was not trying to adjust to technological change. it was going forward more or less by inertia, on momentum. Lower ceilings, more liberal counting rules, more liberal verification systems. And during those past 20 years, a lot of technologies emerged and a lot of new weapons emerged. However, strategic stability. As is well known, strategic stability is the only document that formally produced a definition of strategic stability was a joint declaration of 1990. Being at START negotiations, I worked in this group, and I'm very proud of it. And strategic stability is a state of strategic relationship which removes incentives for first nuclear strike. That is the definition. In view of the new technologies, we may have to somehow adopt it and adjust it. In the past, the threat to strategic stability was considered to be a massive disarming nuclear strike. And the principles of strategic stability were designed to reduce this capability, reducing ratio of warheads to launchers, placing accent on survivable systems, and it was very successful. Now, this is the least of threats to strategic stability. Disarming nuclear strike, we have to watch for it, but it's no longer such a serious threat. The threats are entanglement, conventional system which may attack nuclear weapons, which may do away with nuclear threshold, selective and limited nuclear warfare with new low-yield systems which may be used in order to escalate, to de-escalate, or to prevent escalate, to de-escalate, however you want to formulate it. And so I would formulate the notion of strategic stability at present as the state of strategic relationship which removes incentive for any nuclear use. Understanding that nuclear use may not necessarily be a massive disarming strike, but conventional counterforce attack or selective nuclear employment. How to deal with the new technologies? Well, with INF systems, the treaty is dead. The only hope is to retain and preserve some of its elements. For instance, to agree not to deploy medium-range and short-range systems in Europe. And recently, President Putin wrote a letter to governments of NATO states proposing that just that. NATO flatly rejected it. I think it was a very, very wrong response. Of course, NATO thinks that Russia is already deploying systems which were prohibited under the INF treaty. So if I were in NATO capitals, I would respond to that, that it's a great idea, but let us talk about new verification methods so that we are sure that you are not violating and you are sure that we are not violating with ballistic missile defense deployments, and for instance, in Romania and Poland. New START. I have no doubt it has to be extended to 2026. Not because it's such a wonderful treaty. It's the best we have. But of course, it's largely outdated. But in order to agree on something else, to negotiate something else, something more relevant, we need time. We cannot do it quickly. Next START, the follow-on to START. It's a fascinating subject. I do not have much time left to discuss it. I just only want to mention, I think that follow-on START is not so important with respect to its ceilings. It's much more important in its counting rules. I think it is unacceptable to count air-launched cruise missiles as one warhead and one bomber. We have to get back to realistic counting rules according to actual loading of heavy bombers. Second, the scope of the treaty. I think that addressing the new definition of strategic stability, which I mentioned, we have to limit not only nuclear cruise missiles, but also conventional cruise missiles. Air-launched conventional cruise missiles. And we have to to also address dual purpose systems, because those are now possible incentives for nuclear first strike as a response to such an attack. And finally, the next treaty, of course, should address the new weapon systems which are being developed by Russia and the United States. You know the list, I will not mention it. Avant-Garde, Poseidon, Burevestnik, Skyfall, and so on and so forth. By the way, Poseidon. I was surprised when this nuclear torpedo was called Poseidon, which to my mind was a testimony that the present senior officers at the Ministry of Defense do not know history very well, because it's a plagiary, of course. The first American MIRV SLBM was called Poseidon. What about cyber, drones, and space? For the time being, I do not see solution, at least no easy solutions. I do not see solution to cyber. I do not see easy solution to drones. And I do not see effective solution to do away with space arms, whatever you mean by space arms. But it doesn't mean that arms control, which I mentioned, is not necessary, that it's irrelevant, that we can throw it away because we cannot deal with those other technologies. First of all, because even if we cannot deal with them, nuclear arms control is very important on its own terms. And much of the worry about new technologies is because of their effect of nuclear weapons and their effect of potential uncontrolled escalation of nuclear exchange. So nuclear weapons remain very important. Second, if we do not continue with nuclear arms control, there is no chance that we will be able to deal with new technologies. If we continue with nuclear arms control, there is a chance that eventually we will manage dealing with those new technology as we did during the last 50 years on negotiations and major 9 agreements on nuclear weapons. And finally, if we want to involve third states, doing away with nuclear arms control now leaves no hope of ever involving them. But if we continue, there may be a chance sometime to do that. President Putin recently has changed quite radically his position on many issues related to arms control. I'm not sure that in the United States people are following or made a note of it. Well, soon after he came to power, in 2012, he said, "Nuclear weapons are a guarantee of international security. They are not for aggression, they are for deterrence, period." He didn't say a word about nuclear arms control. Now he is saying that collapse of nuclear arms control is the greatest threat to international security. And he repeats it again and again. Another example, during the last 15 years, INF treaty in Russia was receiving very skeptical attitude. There was a lot of criticism of INF treaty at the very high government levels, to say nothing of parliament, mass media, and professional strategic community. Now Putin is saying, as recently as last December, at the plenary session of the Ministry of Defense, he said, INF treaty was unilateral disarmament of the Soviet Union. Why was it signed? God knows. Now he is saying that INF treaty has been a major factor of regional and global strategic stability. Putin was against extension of New Start. Putin was against follow-on to Start pointing at ballistic missile defenses, conventional precision-guided systems, and so on. Now he's in favor of extension. He is in favor of follow-on to Start, and even said that all new weapon systems, which he portrayed in his famous speech in last year, are subject of negotiations. They are on the table. They are not sacred cows. This is an important change. However, situation is not getting better, but it's getting only worse. And it is absolutely correct that for some reason, political leaders and political elites of the leading countries think that time is on their side. And that was in the article of Ernst and Sam. But the time is not on their side. And I agree with that. Why political leaders are so deaf, so insensitive, senseless about what is happening? I think the explanation is that it's a new generation of political leaders and political elites. And by new generation, I do not necessarily mean age. I mean those political leaders and elites who do not have experience of living through very dangerous crisis of the Cold War, who do not have experience of living through four major cycles of nuclear arms race, which were wasteful, which were dangerous, and which did not enhance security of either party. They have taken, they have accepted arms control for granted when they came to power, and they do not value it sufficiently, and they do not understand, they do not realize what would might be the life without nuclear arms control. And that is why they're treating nuclear arms control not as a principle, one of the principal methods of saving our civilization. They're treating it as a small change in the big political game in the world and domestic political game with various interested groups. It looks now that we are in a state of desolation with respect to world order and with respect to military technologies. And then I would like to end my presentation by citing a famous Russian novelist, Mikhail Bulgakov, of the early 20th century. In one of his novels, his character, medical professor, explains to his servant, "What is desolation? If you stop observing the norms of hygiene in your toilet, you will have desolation. But it's not in your toilet, it's in your head." And I think that that is a very important notion, because changing desolation in the heads of new political leaders and new political elites is the principal way of saving our civilizations in the 21st century. Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you, Alexei. Very interesting indeed, and we're going to open it up for questions. And and everyone should say who they are when they're asking a question.
I'm Liz Sherwood Randall. I'm an NTI board member. Very meaningful presentation. Thank you. And I have a design question for you from your perspective, as you cited the many challenges that we face in the arms control arena. Would you seek to stabilize the strategic nuclear balance first before you put other new capabilities and new platforms and new domains into the mix? So cyber, space, bio, for example, would you hold them aside or would you try to put everything together and develop some sort of Uber agreement? And the other is, would you seek to do US-Russian arms control? But it's really not arms control, it's so much bigger than that. Would you do an US-Russian first, or would you invite others into the conversation? Because you've referenced China, you've described the challenges we face in thinking about INF with China. How would you build the most effective process if you could be the czar and make it happen? Thanks.
Thank you, Liz. I think that strategic nuclear balance is pretty stable according to the definition and to the criteria of the existing notion of strategic stability. It's the new technologies, conventional systems, hypersonic systems, drones and so on, cyber space, which are undermining stability of this balance. So beside reducing the ceilings, which, as I mentioned, is not the most important thing, I would rather address those new systems which are undercutting strategic stability. Not all of them can be addressed immediately. So I would not go for a super treaty which covers everything, because we will never live to have long enough to have such a treaty. It will look more like general complete disarmament. But we can address some of the important issues, which are A, important, B, a subject of possible agreement. Hypersonic systems, for instance. Conventional cruise missiles, long-range cruise missiles, precision-guided systems, which are producing the effect of entanglement and lowering the nuclear threshold. So I think that we should deal with that pace by pace, in a phased way, and when we find a way to address other things like space, like cyber, like drones, we certainly should do that. Continuing with nuclear arms control and with those systems which are the subject of possible agreements in the nearest future will make it easier to deal with new threats. Doing away with this will make it hopeless to do with new technologies. With respect to multilateral or bilateral, I would continue, at least for the next START treaty, follow-on treaty, in a bilateral format. We should certainly invite China, we should talk to them, we should persuade them that it will play up to their prestige and status in the world if they join, but we should not rush with that until and unless we very carefully think through the implications, which I mentioned, because it will not be free. It will demand a lot of ingenuity and a lot of sacrifice and concessions from Russia and the United States to bring China and to make it interested in participation.
Can I just 1 second, if I can follow up a little bit? I think I heard you say that you're very confident that arms control will evolve to handle these new technologies, including cyber, et cetera. And then I hear you say, of course, you don't know how to do it. So what is the basis of your confidence?
I'm not confident that it will be possible to deal with such exotic and esoteric things as cyber warfare. Okay. I just said that we should continue with nuclear and conventional arms control, which is related to strategic balance, even though we cannot simultaneously resolve problems like cyber warfare or drones or space systems. Mm-hmm. That if we continue, eventually we may find the way to deal with the new technologies. If we do not continue, there is no hope that we'll find the way to deal with them.
Okay. And just a follow on that, and then I hear you saying that you think a new architecture of arms control will have to much more intimately include conventional with nuclear.
Right.
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 Yeah.
I
and how do you, and that's another challenge.
that is a challenge, but in fact, I'm not talking about all conventional precision guided systems. Mm-hmm. I'm talking only about long range mm-hmm. conventional precision guided systems. Many of those are dual purpose, so it's mm-hmm. It will be simultaneously dealing right. with conventional and nuclear. Right.
Please.
Can I build on
oh.
that?
Okay, all right. You're next. You're next. Then we'll go over here.
Go ahead. What you just said raises to me the biggest concern about your answer, Alexey, which is that it seems to me we are unlikely to have such a pure situation of a traditional nuclear standoff. If we really escalate to a confrontation, it's much more likely there will be multiple domains active simultaneously, and you could have tremendous instability as a consequence. And so segregating things the way you're proposing to segregate them doesn't seem to me to take stock of the new reality in the strategic balance, which does not appear to me to be as stable as you are presenting it to be. So I think that's why I'm interested in your analysis of the design challenge when you cite all of these new capabilities and platforms and systems, but don't want to put them into the mix. Do you really see that we will only be addressing one another in a traditional nuclear manner?
not traditional nuclear manner, because one of the main points of my proposal is that we also include strategic conventional precision-guided systems, boost light, long-range supersonic missiles, long-range subsonic missiles, which are producing destabilizing effect of strategic stability. With respect to stability, when I said that, to my mind, strategic nuclear balance presently is pretty stable. By definitions of strategic stability that we have, and which is an international norm by the Declaration of 1990, because neither side is capable of initiating and conducting disarming massive nuclear strike against the other that would deprive it of its retaliatory capability or tangibly limit the damage from such a retaliatory capability. I recognize what you say, that there are plenty of other new technologies and systems. It's not that I do not want to include them. It's that I do not know how to include them. And I would not like to wait another 5 or 10 years with continuing nuclear and conventional strategic arms control, because if we wait for another 10 years, we will have neither.
Okay, let's move over here.
Greg Thielman, board member of the Arms Control Association. Alexey, you mentioned the possibility of maintaining elements of the INF Treaty. It seems to me that the most valuable achievements of the INF Treaty in 1987 were eliminating ballistic missiles of INF range category, the SS-20, the Pershing II. There have been no ballistic missile tests of INF range in nearly 32 years yet. Isn't this something which we should focus on, maintaining, even as a political commitment, no test or deployment of INF range ballistic missiles?
Well, certainly that would be a very good agreement or declaration of political intent if we decide that we do not test or deploy, but I would say not only ballistic medium range, intermediate range missiles, I would also add cruise missiles and hypersonic systems, which may be medium range hypersonic systems.
That's what
I mentioned. Maybe Russia deployed it, maybe not. It's a technical question. We can deal with it. Deals with the ratio of fuel tank and the warhead weight of this Novator of 9M729, as everybody knows this bizarre name of this missile. But in order to make sure that they are not deployed, you have to agree to additional verification measures. The whole issue of mutual blame of violation is because there is no verification system any longer. It existed for 10 years, period. And if we had it, we would probably be able to avoid these recriminations. We would be able to on-site inspection mechanism, which would prove to Americans that the systems deployed in Russia in 4 battalions are exactly the systems that were shown in the Patriot Park in January of this year. If Russia is unable to do that, then it is to be blamed, and then it has to cancel those, to eliminate those systems.
Okay, well, I was supposed to be against the wall there, right? Okay.
Hi, Alexey. The last time I heard you talk about the new technologies was it in
rank, serial number.
UNDLO. I'm Jeff Smith at the Center for Public Integrity. What thought have you given to what kind of limits could actually be imposed with regard to hypersonic systems? There isn't a lot of study going on in the United States of this. In fact, the Army is considering a ground launch version, the Air Force is planning an air launched version, and the Navy is considering a sea launched version of a hypersonic missile. So it's basically an enthusiastic embrace of the technology rather than a consideration of how it might how some limits might be agreed. I wrote about this for the New York Times Magazine in June, and surveyed people here before writing that and didn't find much interest in Washington in hypersonic limits. So I'm just curious to know whether anybody on your side of the equation has actually thought about how they might, there are problems with the size, there are problems with the multiple different deployments, deployment modes. There are a lot of challenges to overcome, and I'm just curious to know if you've thought about how to do that.
If we are talking about hypersonic cruise missiles, for instance, like rapid reaction, advanced rapid reaction system, which is developed by the United States, if it is of the range which exceeds 600 kilometers, which is the cutting edge of counting LCAMs, then we have to deal with them like we deal with LCAMs, regardless of whether they are supersonic or subsonic. You count them according to actual loading of bombers. If we are talking about boost glide systems, then if they are medium-range boost glide systems, they are to be dealt with like we dealt with medium-range ballistic missiles. And they are, would most probably use ballistic missile stages as a booster. And verification is not more difficult than it was with medium-range ballistic missiles, like Pershing 2, like SS-20. If we are talking about intercontinental hypersonic systems, then we should address them as we addressed ICBMs, both in counting rules and in verification procedures. We would agree on the number of warheads or reentry vehicles, maybe a single warhead, maybe it's multiple warhead, and then we will apply to them the same methods. But in general, I would say that I think that there is too much hype around hypersonic systems now. Certainly at a theater level, they are very important because at a theater level, there is permanent competition between defense and offense with changing success, and hypersonic systems could really change the situation, at least for some time ahead. If we're talking about strategic systems, then the problem with hypersonic systems is that their effect and their actual use is very uncertain. Of course, they cannot be tracked by land-based radars until the impact. But they can be detected by satellites. The launch may be detected by satellites. I'm not sure that they may produce such a revolution in strategic balance as sometimes ascribed to them. And of course, I do not mean professionals present here, but the general public is impressed by the word hypersonic because they do not know that any ballistic missile with a range of more than 300 kilometers is hypersonic, and that has been for 60 years with us.
Yeah, we're going to move over here first to a question. Then we'll come back.
Thanks, Alexey, for your excellent talk.
Who are you?
Pardon?
Who are you, Frank?
Oh, Frank von Hippel, Princeton University. I may have missed it, but you know, you didn't spend much time on ballistic missile defense, which is, I think, what my impression is that that's what's been driving Putin and the Chinese crazy, and in terms of new systems and in the case of the Chinese, a buildup. Did I miss something, or could I extract something more from you?
I certainly understand why China might be concerned about it, at least in the past. I do not think any longer, because with their strategic systems development, with MIRVing that they are implementing, American ballistic missile defense is no longer a serious problem for them. It has never been such for the Soviet Union or Russia. Probably some people, even in high quarters, think differently. But anyway, the new package of systems that Putin proposed last year, and some of them are already deployed, this avant-garde boost glide system, there allegedly
were needed to overcome any conceivable American ballistic missile defense. So why worry?
All right, well, next year, then we'll get the hand in the back, then we'll come over here.
I'm Michael Crapon with Stimson. Alexey, would you extend your argument about the hypervelocity systems to every new technology that can take the form of a strategic nuclear delivery vehicle? In other words, if I heard you correctly, with respect to the hypers, they're niche vehicles. They're not MIRVs. They're not cruise missiles. So would you extend your argument that far? But would you also acknowledge that the stuff you're putting in the too hard category, those things are MIRV-like. They're cruise missile-like. They are cyber, for example. They're capable of messing everything up, even if we get the numbers down and correct.
I think that with respect to cyber, artificial intellect, the situation is very uncertain. I do not have clear idea what those technologies would mean for strategic balance. I do not have clear idea whether offensive or defensive cyber warfare would be ahead and at what time. I do not have clear idea whether cyber warfare might affect more drastically planning massive counterforce strike or planning retaliation. So in all those, I would not go as far as saying that those are like MIRVs, those are like cruise missiles, those are like SDI if it were ever developed and deployed. No. At least their consequences and implications is a matter of the future, and it's too early to make any judgment, and it's too early to provide some ways of controlling them.
And the niche thing?
What is niche?
Niche is you don't need many of them for the technologies that can become strategic nuclear delivery vehicles. You don't need many. They're a special capability for special circumstances. Just need a few.
Like for decapitating strike or what?
We're adding hypervelocity capabilities to ballistic missile capabilities with hypervelocity characteristics, as you say. So how many of them do we need?
Well, I think, I do not know how many, depends on development of technology and cost effectiveness. I do not think that that nuclear hypersonic boost glide systems may create a revolution in strategic balance. Conventional hypersonic ICB or intercontinental systems, if deployed in sufficient numbers and if provided with very high accuracy, might produce a revolution. But we have to live up to that time. As of now, it's possible to suggest that it would be very difficult to provide hypersonic intercontinental systems with accuracy which would be enough to hit very hardened targets. They will because of the plasma plume. They cannot have homing capacity, they cannot have external navigation and guidance, they will have to slow down. Then they are becoming subjects for electronic countermeasures and interception.
Okay, there was a hand up here. Yeah, there we are.
Hi, my name is Ken Brill. I'm a former diplomat. Thanks for a very interesting talk. I wanted to go back to your comments on
on the President Putin's changing message and ask you, why do you think he's making that shift? What are his, what's underlying that? And also, what kinds of discussions are going on amongst people who think about arms control in Moscow below the presidential level, looking to the future?
In Moscow, if you remember my three new schools of thought, I would say that in professional strategic community, about 70% are nuclear revanchists. About 20% are nuclear revisionists. And the rest are nuclear idealists. And 2 or 3% are nuclear realists, to which I belong.
I was hoping you weren't counting 100% there in those three schools, right?
And the first question was
about what do you ascribe to this change of message, and does that reflect his thinking?
I've met Putin several times personally, and of course I'm following whatever he says. I'm trying to analyze that. My experience is that it's very easy to find explanation of why Putin has changed his position. But in advance, you can never predict the change of that position. And you can never be sure that your explanation of changed position is correct.
Okay. Okay, please.
Cynthia Roberts, I'm on sabbatical here working in Washington for the year. Alexei, you said many things that are interesting, including in reference to President Putin, but I'll put that aside and ask a more specific question. You said that ceilings didn't matter much and you were more focused on counting rules. So let me ask two parts that come out of that. One is, well, how would President Putin and Russia count the new Russian weapon systems, that nuclear systems that have been deployed and that he announced and showed in his speech? He hasn't made that clear. And the second is, clearly we would be more concerned about ceilings and not just counting rules. So I get that the grievance about the bomber and the Alcum, that makes sense. But for us, with extended deterrence requirements, we're going to care a lot about ceilings, especially when we look at Russia and China's increased deployments, which Russia says don't exist, but they do exist in Europe, which is why all the Europeans and NATO are so concerned about these deployments and potentially continuing deployments of intermediate range capabilities, which raise serious questions for our extended deterrence requirements. So could we bridge this gap somehow? Thank you.
I probably did not express myself clearly enough. Ceilings are important. And actually, ceilings and counting rules are two sides of the same coin. What I said was that in the follow-on start, reducing the ceiling from 1,500, say, to 1,000 or to 1,300 is not so important. What is important is counting rules, because depending on counting rules, if you count Alcums as individual warheads, we presently do not have 1,500, we have more than 2,000. If you include the counting rule in the existing New START ceiling, that would mean a drastic reduction in ballistic missiles. That's why I emphasized counting rules so much. And with respect to deployments of China, Russia, the way to deal with that, I think, is the best way to deal with that is through arms control negotiations and agreements.
My question was, why not combine the two? Why not just count and say, let's have a ceiling on theater and strategic combined and mix as you wish? If Russia decides it needs more intermediate capabilities as opposed to strategic, and we decide that we need to limit them in some ceiling or deploy some of our own, why not do it that way?
And if you want to bring China into that as well, you may.
Yes. Well, I think this is a very good idea. We are working on it, on this idea. I just didn't want to deviate from the mainstream of my presentation. I think that one of the ways of dealing with INF treaty abrogation is to have the next start, which would limit not only strategic systems with realistic counting rules, but also would include limitation on all land-based ballistic and cruise missiles at intermediate range, or even maybe intermediate and shorter range. And, but then your ceiling probably would have to be a bit higher than it is now. And if you want to include China, certainly it would be as high as 2,000. If China presently has 2,000 INF weapons, according to American official statement, then 2,000 would be the ceiling for them and for Russia and for the United States, with some leeway, some freedom to mix between strategic and medium-range systems. But I insist on including conventional systems as well. And this option makes it absolutely necessary, because most of Chinese medium-range systems are conventional. And according to American position, all envisioned deployments of American medium-range systems would be conventional as well. So we have to include conventional. That's additional argument in favor of what I proposed earlier about conventional outcomes.
Liz, your reward for staying is you have a second question.
Thank you. I want to follow up on Frank von Hippel's question about missile defenses, because in the previous administration, our experience was that this was an issue of enormous importance to Russia. And so the way I heard your answer to his question suggested that perhaps it isn't, and maybe I misunderstood you. But as you think about the kind of negotiation that you've proposed, and especially in response to the last question, bringing in both tactical and strategic, does missile defense have to be included in that negotiation too? Or is that a separate endeavor? Because I'm interested in the Russian perspective here, because it seemed to me that that would be essential to get Russian agreement on limitations.
Russian perspective is expressed by President Putin, best of all. And in his recent statement about extension of START, about the necessity to think about follow-on treaty for which all new weapon systems of Russia would be subject of negotiations, he never uttered a word about ballistic missile defenses. Whether that's important or not, impossible to judge. But certainly, if you believe official position of Russian Federation, in the past it was serious factor. Now, with all those avant-gardes and Burevestnik and so on, ballistic missile defense is no longer our concern. I think that both proposals are wrong, but that is the official position. The defenses in the past.
So the new system, new systems could contribute to more stability.
I am saying that the new systems might contribute to more stability, and ballistic missile defense is no longer an obstacle for negotiations. Right. But those systems are subject of trade-offs. Mm-hmm. If you agree, for instance, to some limitation on forward-based standard ballistic missile defenses, Russia might cancel. Theoretically, of course, I'm not disclosing.
We're negotiating right here.
Yes, yeah. Right. might cancel the Poseidon system, which, to my mind, is irrational. It's a weapon in search of a mission. But like many other systems, including hypersonics.
All right. Is there a last question? As we're going to be wrapping it up. And one last question. Because there'll be time to discuss more. At a reception that we'll have just outside the room.
Thank you. Edward F. Stanford University. I accept your statement, Alexei, that cyber and space and drones may be just too difficult for now. But isn't there one exception to that. Why could we not ban the stationing of kill mechanisms in orbit? It seems to me that could be highly destabilizing. We could define that. Verification might be a problem, but not an insurmountable problem, in my view.
Well, that is the Russian-Chinese proposed draft treaty on prevention of deployment of weapons in space. I personally think that this treaty does not have prospects for any practical application, because kill weapon doesn't have a clear definition. What is kill weapon? What is destructive weapon? Is a satellite which comes to rendezvous with another satellite, is it a kill weapon? Are the lasers based on the ground, like Pirisvet, that's another of Putin's favorite systems? Is this a system which you can consider a kill system? Besides dealing with something unknown and uncertain, weapons in space, we may miss something which is already here. Land and sea-based and air-based anti-satellite systems, which already exist, which were tested, and this draft treaty avoids completely this subject. I think that we should start with something which exists, which has technical characteristics, which may be a subject of verification procedures, rather than dealing with, eye in the sky, or what, bird in the sky?
Eye in the sky,
which is absolutely, the problem with this draft is it's very well-intentioned, but it's very general. It's like saying, let's agree not to deploy kill mechanisms at sea or in the air. I do not think that this is a practical proposition without technical characteristics, verification procedures, and clear understanding on their effect on strategic stability. Anti-satellite systems, if used against early warning satellites, would certainly be a tremendously destabilizing system, maybe more destabilizing than counter-force MIRVed missiles. And that is to be addressed in the immediate future, not some abstract systems which can strike Earth from space, or which can perform the functions of space-based ballistic missile defense. Many of those people who are scared about this, they just do not know the laws of space dynamics of Kepler and Newton. That's the problem.
Right, well, we want to thank Alexei for giving us a lot to think about more, and but also, as I said, the opportunity to chat a bit more in the reception. So thank you, Alexei.
Thank you.